We are Christ living under my bride.
You need a strong east wind. You need a strong east wind to blow out your preconceived ideas. You need a strong east wind to blow out your religion. You need a strong east wind to blow out the doctrine of the scribes and Pharisees, which still possess your soul because you've not allowed the Holy Ghost to move in you and set you free.
A ministry with a vision. A ministry on the move. A ministry established by our faith in the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Think what God wants to do in his people is make his supernatural Holy Ghost fire and power clear to our sight, clear to our mind, so that there is no doubt in our spiritual creation who God is.
Bible for Christ Love International Ministry, a ministry with a vision built on a plan. God.
Come on up, honey. Hallelujah. We're chilling tonight. But we got the man and woman of God in the house, and we are so excited to have you once again. We know we're going to hear a great word tonight from you, from the Holy Ghost.
From the Holy Ghost.
From the Holy Ghost. You just going to be the vessel, right? Amen.
I'm just like his microphone. Whatever he speaks into is going to come out.
Amen.
So I'm gonna be a really good mic.
You're gonna be that merchant ship tonight,
yes,
right?
Sir.
Amen. Somebody see there, you gotta listen. Amen. I'm here and I'm waiting. Amen. I'm at the port waiting for you to dock tonight. Amen. Amen. So listen, I'm gonna turn it over to you.
Okay, praise God.
Let God use you. God bless you. I'm out the way.
We love you guys.
We love you too.
We love each and every one of you that are watching. Hey, let's give a big praise and worship right now to Greater Love Assembly right here. We thank God for this church. Thank God for these people. And Jenny and I are thrilled to be here. The Revival for Christ Club Eagle Flight Team is ready to be here. Now listen, if you're watching and you're anywhere in the area, come out. We're going to have a great time in the Lord. You won't want to miss it. Right now, I'm going to get out of the way. I'm going to let the praise and worship team get right at it tonight. So everybody put your hands together for the wonderful Tasha Sanders and the Eagle Flight Praise Team.
Jesus. You're worthy, God, I worship you. Take everything, I don't want it, I don't need it, God, take everything in your soul, I don't want it, I don't need it, God, take everything, I don't want it, I don't need it, God, so take everything, oh, that must stop. Woo! I don't want it, I don't need it, oh, I just want you. I just want you.
I just want you.
I just want you.
I just want you.
I just want you.
I just want you.
I just want you.
I just want you.
I just want you.
I just want you.
I just want you. Everything, I don't want it, I don't need it, God, I just want you,
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 I just want you. just want you. I just want you.
I just want you.
I just want you. Father, we've come tonight to die out to ourselves. God, to surrender everything that's not like you. God, let it be burned in the fire. Father, cleanse us, God, and let us be the vessels you've called us to be. We've come tonight to praise you. We've come tonight to yield. We've come tonight to be made new by your word. Take everything that's not like you. That's not like you. That's not like you. That's not like you. I surrender, God. I give it to you. Every hindrance, everything, I give to you. I yield to you. I humble myself before you, God. I'm nothing without you. I'm nothing without you. I yield to you. I yield to you. I yield to you.
I'm nothing without you.
Take it, God. Take it, God. Everything that's not like you, I give it to you, Lord. Take everything. I don't want it. I don't need it, God. If it doesn't glorify you, I don't need it, God. If it doesn't set me free, God, I don't need it, God. If it doesn't bring healing to me, I don't need it, God. If it doesn't set me free, I don't need it, God. If it doesn't bring me healing, I don't need it, God. If it doesn't set me free, I don't need it, God. I don't need it, God. I don't need it, God. If it doesn't set me free, I don't need it, God. If it doesn't bring me healing, I don't need it, God. 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 If it doesn't set me free, I don't need it, God. If it doesn't change my heart, I don't need it, God. If it doesn't change my mind, I don't need it, God.
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 If it doesn't set me free, I don't need it, God.
Need it, God.
If it doesn't bring me healing, I don't need it, God.
Need it,
if
God.
It doesn't change my mind, I don't need it, God.
I
surrender
God.
To you.
It,
surrender
I
to you. If it doesn't set me free, I don't need it.
God.
If it doesn't heal me, I don't need it.
God.
If it doesn't change me, I don't need it.
God.
I don't need it. I don't need it. I worship you from my heart tonight, Jesus. Father, fill this place with your glory. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is Jesus, to break every chain, 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 break every chain. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name to break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. There is power
Lord, break every chain, 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 break every chain. I hear those chains falling, Jesus. I hear those chains falling. Thank you, Father. I hear those chains falling.
I wish somebody would praise him.
I hear those chains falling. 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 There's an army rising up. There's an army rising up. There's an army rising up. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain.
Special speaker tonight. It's our very own chief apostle, Timothy Vanover. He is the international president and founder of Revival for Christ Club International Ministries. Amen? Chief Apostle has served the Lord his entire life. He's been baptized with the Holy Ghost since age 11 and started preaching at the age of 12. God's hand has been mighty in our Chief Apostle's life. He started, he received a powerful and anointed vision of our ministry, this ministry, Revival for Christ Club, amen? Which each and every one of us are a part of. Chief Apostle Timothy Vanover is international speaker, preacher, teacher, and author, proclaiming God's authority and bringing revival to the body of Christ. Over the years, he's been featured in many radio and television programs such as TBN, ABC, CBS, and Fox. He worked with Sun Life Radio, a part of the Jimmy Swaggart Evangelistic Association, worked locally with KJIL FM 105, first as a morning disc jockey and later promoted as a concert manager for many great artists, such as Leon Battello, the Garmin and the Key Band, Dottie Rambo, Jeremy Camp, Vicky Yohe, Carmen, and that's just to mention a few. Chief Apostle is playwright and founder of America's only full-time Christian dinner theater, amen? Yeah. His ministry serves as an encouragement for the body of Christ to rise up and be everything that God has called them to be, amen? Chief Apostle, along with his wife, Apostle Jenny, hosts RFC Club's program, Christ Family Apostolic Network, amen, under Apostle Larry Fisher, amen. This is our Chief Apostle's quote, and listen carefully, because this quote only comes from a very humble man of God. He says, "My only desire is to see people experience the fullness of our Heavenly Father in all of His glory and power. I give Him and Him alone all the glory and honor for anything I've accomplished in Him," amen. And if you stand up to your feet right now, and when I introduce this speaker, I want you guys to make a thunderous shout to the Lord, amen, because we're not reverencing a man, we're reverencing the Lord. So here is our Chief Apostle, Timothy Vanover. Hallelujah!
Praise the Lord. Thank you, Mr. Mario.
Dear Heavenly Father God, as we come before you, we come not in our own ability nor by our own power, but God, we come by the anointing and the Spirit of a living God. Father, I pray tonight that you will dynamite anoint this word tonight. God, that it will break through and touch us, establish us, and encourage us in our calling and in our faith. In Jesus' mighty and powerful name. Holy Ghost, you got the charge. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Praise the Lord. You can be seated if you want to. Hey, this is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Are you glad that you're saved, sanctified, Holy Ghost filled, and five baptized? I know I am. Now, first of all, the first thing that I want to say, we are living in one of the most fascinating times that's ever occurred in church history. This is the most fascinating time, but it's also the most challenging and the most difficult and the most divisive, and where the enemy has fought so difficultly against everyone. Because you see, one of the things that's happened, the church has allowed the enemy to lullaby them to sleep. And because they've allowed the church to lullaby them to sleep, the church is no, oh Lord help me, the church no longer roars. Come on, you'll hear me. I said the church does not roar anymore. I said all the church does is purr like a little kitty cat. We ain't acting like the lion of the tribe of Judah. We're not acting like what God called us to be. Bless God, church, it is time to roar. You got to get back to roaring, amen. And roar is spelled R-O-A-R. I spelled that right, didn't I? R-O-A-R. And it stands for righteous, overcoming, anointed revelation. The reason the church has lost its roar is it abandoned righteousness. Come on, you're not hearing me. It abandoned righteousness. We're not interested in being right standing with God. We're only interested in being right standing with our own opinion, our own idea, and what we think. But honey, we got to get to a place where righteousness with God is more important. And then when we get that righteousness with God, it will give us the ability to overcome.
We'll begin to overcome those things that challenge us, those things that try to tear us down, those elements that come against us. And once we begin to become overcomers, once we become victorious over those things that bring distractions, those things that come to hinder us, those things that come to steal, kill, and destroy what God has put in us, then it's going to release an anointing. Think about this. Every time you're victorious over something the devil did, it builds your faith. It increases the anointing that is in you. Amen? So then you got righteousness overcoming, anointed, and then once that anointing begins to stir, once we begin to get out of the way and let the anointing of God begin to move, guess what happens? Revelation begins to flow. Revelation begins to come forth. The Bible is no longer just scriptures on a page. The Bible is no longer a quote here and a quote there. But the Bible is a river of life, a river of righteousness, a river of holiness. That once you grab hold of, it will change you forever. Now see, the problem is, oh Lord, I'm going to get in trouble. Brother Fisher, I'm going to get you in trouble. Praise the Lord. Here's the thing. We're so busy being relevant, we are no longer revelational. Oh, y'all ain't listening to me. We're so busy being relevant, we are no longer revelational. Let me tell you about relevant. Relevant doesn't last past a decade. Oh, somebody hear me. I said relevancy does not pass through a decade. What may be relevant today will not be relevant 10 years from now. And what's relevant 10 years from now won't be relevant the next 10. But the beauty of revelation is it never dissipates. The beauty of revelation, it never loses its power, never loses anointing, never loses authority. Because what is revelation all about? It's about God revealing himself to you and you revealing yourself to God in a power of spiritual intimacy, which removes the hindrances and the blocks so that God can begin to bring a change. Without revelation, there is no transformation. And where there is no transformation, there can be no manifestation. And you were called for manifestation. So if you're going to be a manifested people, you got to start embracing a revelation. You've got to start letting it transform you so that you can be what God called you to be. Amen. How many of you love the Lord tonight? Amen. All right. I'm sorry. I got a little excited. All right. What I'm going to preach on tonight is a message that God gave me earlier this year. And a lot of places I've been going, the Lord's been having me preach it. So I'm going to preach it here to start this revival off. But everywhere I preach, it's a little bit different. So I know it's going to be a little different for here. But I want to preach it for you tonight. See, I got a question that I got to ask. Something I just don't understand. When it comes to the ministry, there's lots of people who got all kinds of requirements for the ministry. But what amazes me is they do not have the requirement that Jesus demanded. Are you listening to me? Jesus, I'm going to show it to you in the Bible. I'm going to show you scripture. Stay with me. Honey, I'm going to tell you something. Jesus had a requirement for every single person in ministry. And I'm going to make you mad, you can spit. If you ain't got the requirement, you are not in ministry. You're not listening to me. If you don't have the requirement, you cannot stand behind this pulpit and break the bread of life. You cannot stand up here and minister the word of God if you do not have the one requirement Jesus commanded. Jesus demanded. And I'm going to tell you something. It makes the devil so mad. It makes the devil so upset. See, we believe in seeking man's wisdom and education and becoming a minister, yet we ignore or justify away the simply reject the one requirement that Jesus had for all of his disciples and everybody that ever followed Jesus. As a matter of fact, it was a requirement that it's, if you do not have it, you cannot serve him in the manner in which he wants you to serve him. Amen? Now, let me ask you a question. You've even got to, if you drive, you got to get a driver's license. If you're a doctor, you got to get a medical license. If you're a lawyer, you got to pass the bar, right? Then why is it so hard to believe that when you serve Jesus, there's a requirement? Why is it so hard to believe there's a requirement? Just one requirement. So go with me. We're going to talk about this requirement tonight. Oh, praise the Lord. I want you to go with me, if you would, to St. Luke chapter 24. St. Luke chapter 24. This is where Jesus first commanded them to wait for the requirement. See, now, you know, I always think it's funny because, you know, people have all kinds of ideas and they tell you different things like, well, this is the promise and that's this and that's this and this is that. Well, you know, there's only one thing that Jesus ever called the promise. Did you know that? There's only one thing in the Bible he ever called a promise, and it wasn't him. Do you understand? It wasn't him. He said, I will give unto you the promise of my Father. He said, I came here not just to save your soul. I came here not just to clean that tabernacle out, but to fill that tabernacle with something that would transform it and change it for all eternity. Let's go on. We're going to go. St. Luke chapter 24 and verse 46. 24 and 46. And they said unto him, thus is it written, and thus it behoved Christ to suffer and rise from the dead on the third day. And the repentance and remission of sins should be preached in the name among the sons, beginning at Jerusalem. Amen? And you are all witnesses to these things. Now they saw Jesus crucified. They saw him risen from the dead. They heard him. And they were ready, man. They wanted to run out. They were ready to start reviving. They were ready to start having evangelism. They were ready to go. But look what Jesus told him. He said, and behold. Now wait a minute. I thought Jesus was to promise. According to the play in Branson, Jesus to promise. But he said, behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you. And he said, but tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until you be endued. Oh, somebody shout with me. Till you be endued with what? Come on, church, I can't hear you. Till you be endued with what? Jesus told those disciples, don't you go out and speak about me. Don't you go out and preach about me. Don't go out and witness to what you think you saw until you got the Holy Ghost to interpret it for you. Oh, you're not listening to me. He said, you know what you think you saw, but the Holy Ghost will tell you what you really saw. Can you say praise God? He said, I don't want you saying nothing until you feel the Holy Ghost. It's not my word. That's Jesus. He said, tarry ye in Jerusalem till you be endued with power from on high. Let's go to Acts chapter 1. Acts chapter 1 verse 2. Until the day in which he was taken up, after that he threw what? I'm sorry, how did Jesus operate? I'm sorry, how did Jesus operate? How did Jesus operate? Bible says he did it through the Holy Ghost. I'm going to tell you, let me tell you something cool about Christ. Something amazing about Jesus. Jesus was, is, and always will be the only begotten Son of God. He's the only begotten Son of God. We're adopted, but he's the only begotten. And he had something his Father had. He had a divine nature. He had a deity, a divine nature. Now, the beautiful part about Jesus, he never, even though he was tempted by Satan, tempted when he was on the cross by people, he never used that deity. He never used it. What he did was, if you remember, what he keeps saying, Jesus didn't walk around saying, I'm the Son of God. What did he say? I'm the Son of Man. Son of Man, Son of Man, Son of Man. He looked at the disciples and said, who do you say I am? They said, you're the Son of the living God. He said, flesh and blood had not revealed this unto you, but my Father which art in heaven. And upon this rock shall I build the church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Honey, he wasn't talking about building a church on Peter. He was talking about the knowledge and wisdom and understanding that Peter applied that did not come from flesh and blood, but came by the Spirit of God. And that's the problem. We're busy trying to build our churches on men when we need to be building them on the revelational truth of God's word. Can you say amen? Let's go on. I got a lot to do. We gotta go. Acts chapter 1. Acts chapter 1. Back where he's at. He says, but he through the Holy Ghost had given commandments unto the apostles whom he had chosen, to whom he also showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days. A lot of people don't realize Jesus was alive after the resurrection for 40 days. I don't have time to get on all that tonight, but put this click, 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 equal. 40 days he was after his resurrection, he spent 40 days in the wilderness. So praise God. I don't know what the connections are, but there's some spiritual connections there. Okay, let's go ahead. To whom? Okay, I said that. Okay. And being being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father. Now, what makes this interesting? Come on, how many of you love the Lord? What makes this interesting is this is the book of what? What book is this? What book did I just read to you, the first scripture? Luke. Who wrote Acts? Luke did. Luke wrote Acts. So basically what Luke's doing, he's taking over right where he left off. He's taking over right where he left off. He said, the Lord said, tarry. He said, I'm going to tell you what that tarrying is going to do. See, I'm going to tell you something. You think because you got a nurtured, and nincompoop education, you're ready to stand behind a pulpit and preach. But let me tell you something. Till you have the promise, till you have the anointing, till you have the authority of God, all you will do is mislead people. And that's dangerous. Because if you don't take them to the well, you're taking them to the pit. So take them to the well. Let's go and look what he said. He says, oh, I love this part. And being assembled together, they shall not depart from Jesus until they receive the promise of the Father. He saith, ye have heard of me. I want you to listen to what he says here. For John truly baptized with water. One baptism. Okay, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. Two baptisms. Water and fire, water and fire, water and fire. That's what they are. Whether you like it or not, water and fire. Now, isn't it funny? When Jesus said this, he said, John did indeed baptize you with water. He said, but not many days hence. You're going to be baptized with the Holy Ghost, and you're going to be baptized with fire. Now, he didn't say that Jesus' baptism was going to be the same as John. He said it was going to be totally different. Honey, let me tell you something. There's a difference between water, and there's a difference between fire. They're as far apart as you can get. Can I tell you the difference in them? Can I tell you the difference? Water washes dirt off, but the dirt comes back. Come on, hear me now. I said water washes the dirt off, but you have to take more water tomorrow and more water the next day. See, when they went down in that water 2,000 years ago, it was a statement to our Heavenly Father that as hard as I've tried, I can't make it. As good as the law is, it's in flesh and I'll never make it. They had to come to the point where they realized they could not do it in themselves. And then when they realized that, they went in that water. And it was a cry out for a Savior. It was a cry out for someone to save them and redeem them. You understand something? John himself said, I baptize you with water. But oh Lord, there is one coming whose shoe latches. I am not worthy to unloose. And he's going to baptize you with the Holy Ghost. Oh, somebody say it. Holy Ghost and fire. He didn't say he was just going to amend John's baptism. He said he was going to overcome even better than what John had. John washed you. Jesus wants to burn you. Come on, hear me. Y'all didn't hear me. Y'all didn't hear me. Let me explain it to you. You wash the dirt off, but you get back in the muck, you're going to get dirty all over again. You get back in the muck, you're going to get dirty again. But let me tell you something. When you got fire, do you know what fire does? Fire is a refiner and a purifier. Oh, somebody hear me. Honey, dirt falls on fire. Whoosh, it is consumed. Dirt falls on fire. Whoosh, it is consumed. Why do you think he wants the Holy Ghost in you? So anytime sin tries to rise, anytime the devil tries to rise, if you bring your flesh under subjection and allow the Holy Spirit to rise, it will consume every ounce of dirt around you on every side. Water washed, but fire purified. Can you say amen? Let's go. I got to hurry. So they waited there. I like what he says here. And when they had come together, they asked him, saying, Lord, will this be the time to restore again the kingdom of Israel? They're still looking on the physical. They're still wanting this to be taken care of. He says, man, this is nothing, guys. My kingdom is far surpassing to anything here. And he goes on and says, he comes on and says, he said unto them, it is not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father hath put in his own power. But ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. And you shall be witnesses of me, both in Jerusalem, in Judea, in Samaria, and unto the uttermost parts of the earth. Now this is red letter edition. This is Jesus. He made one requirement. Don't speak, don't go, don't teach, don't minister, don't do nothing till you have received the promise of the Father. Now, this is the requirement Jesus had for his disciples. And I've heard preachers preach that that was just for the disciples. That wasn't for us. And last time I checked the Bible, it says, my God's the same yesterday, today, forever, has no shadow of changing. Right? He makes a plan. He sticks to it. Amen? This was his plan, that you be filled with the baptism of the Holy Ghost, that you operate in the Holy Ghost. Now, I'm going to tell you. I'm going to show you the word. Stick with me. Amen? Why don't you go with me? Let's go over to the day of Pentecost. Acts chapter 2, verse 1. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, and they were all with one accord in one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues as of fire, and it set upon each one of them. And they were what? I'm sorry, they were what? They were what? They were what? They were filled with the Holy Ghost. They begin to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave utterance. See, just like when you get baptized in water, there's physical evidence. You're wet. You come up wet. When you get filled with the baptism of the Holy Ghost, you speak in tongues. That's the physical manifestation of it. It's your mouth. It's your tongue. It's His language. Can you say praise God? How many times you blinked your eyes today? You count how many times you blink them? One, two, three. You don't even know, do you? How many times you take a breath today? I'll bet you don't know. How many times your heart beat today? You don't know. Why you make it so complicated with the Holy Ghost? You don't know how many times you blink your eyes, don't know how many breaths you have, don't know which heartbeat is, and you want to make the Holy Ghost all complicated. You think it's supposed to come down in this mighty cloud and land on top of your head, and then something's going to happen. Holy Ghost happens from the inside. It is a chamber reaction to love. Come on, it's a chamber reaction to your relationship with Jesus Christ. And you need to understand something. Honey, when that Holy Ghost begins to live in you and dwell in you, the language that comes out of you is not yours. It is your Heavenly Father's. And it is the Spirit overwhelming the flesh and releasing the characteristics of Jesus Christ. So while they were in that upper room, they got filled with the Holy Ghost. Amen? So, I set up a little standard here for you. Jesus had one requirement, that his disciples tarry in Jerusalem till they be endued with power from on high. When they got there, he said, this is the promise of my Father, that you would be filled with the Holy Ghost. He said, John indeed baptized you with water, but I got something a little stronger. It's called the Holy Ghost. Amen? Even John himself said, and I don't know why nobody pays attention to this. John himself said, I do, but he's coming. He's going to do it with the Holy Ghost and fire. And he says, I must. He didn't say, I must decrease that he may replace me and do the same work I'm doing. He said, I must decrease. My work is being done. My work has been done. I am the bridegroom's friend. I am not the bridegroom. I am here to make the way for the bridegroom. I'm here to open up the way for the bridegroom. But bless God, when the bridegroom comes to the altar, when the bridegroom comes to his bride, he doesn't need the bridegroom's friend anymore. Doesn't need him anymore. The devil would love to get us running around circles, chasing our tails, doing things over and over again, instead of moving forward in what God's called. Now, I'm going to tell you something. This is somehow we've been deceived, and I want to remove that deception from the church today. How essential and important it is to have the requirement. Now, I want you to think about something for a minute. Yes, God required the disciples to tarry in Jerusalem, be endued with power from on high. He wanted them to be filled with the Holy Ghost, but it wasn't really for anybody else. It was just for them. Well, first of all, if you were to continue to read in Acts 2, you would find out several thousand people got it the same day, a little bit later down the line. Amen? But Can I tell you how heavy this requirement was? We know how many disciples were there? How many? No, 11. Judas killed himself. So there's only 11 at the end, right? When he told him to tarry, there wasn't 12, was there? There was 11. But the disciples knew the significance of 12. They knew the importance of 12, the 12 tribes of Israel, the 12 stones on the ephod. They knew all the, there's a spiritual significance to 12, and they knew that. So they needed to add another person. So the disciples, in their ultimate wisdom and knowledge, as man usually does in his stupidity, decided to do it in themselves. And they picked the 12th disciple. Did you know that? Do you know what the 12th disciple's name was? Do you? No, you don't. No, neither does very many other people. His name was Matthias. He was the 12th disciple picked to replace Judas. Now, what old Matthias did, or the 13, he would actually be 13 because Judas was 12. So he was the replacement, 13. But how did they pick him? They rolled dice. They cast lots to pick him. That's how they picked him. Now, while they were busy trying to do what God never asked them to do, trying to do what they thought they should do, God went out and found the real replacement. Oh, somebody hear me. God went out and found a real replacement. God said, you cast your little lots, I got a better plan. You cast your little lots, I got a better plan. And honey, on the road to Damascus, when he was traveling with letters from the rabbis to declare that Christians were enemies of the church, to have them put to death and thrown into prison, he saw a bright and shining light that spoke out to him and said, Saul, Saul, it is hard for you to kick against the pricks. And he said, who art thou? And he said, I am Jesus, whom you persecuted. God said, I'll get me my own disciple. I'll get Saul. You know who he is. I'll get this rascal. And so, but it's real simple. Saul, certainly, who later became Paul, we all know him because he wrote more than 70% of the New Testament. So, but let's say this part. So Paul, on the road to Damascus, gets blinded. He can't see. He's leading somebody, has to get somebody to lead him by the hand and take him to the town of Antioch. Now, Saul has decided, I give up. I'm going to surrender to the Lord. I'm going to give it up to the Lord. But isn't it funny? What is the very next thing that God requires of Saul after he surrenders to God? What is it? What is the next thing he required before Saul's vision was healed? Before he sent the man to heal him? He said, boy, you got to have the requirement. You got to get your requirement. And I want you to look. I'll prove it to you. Show you in the Bible. Go on. He's still blind. He's still in the deal. And here he comes. Go with me. Acts chapter 9, verse 10. Okay. And there was a certain disciple at Damascus named Ananias. And to him said the Lord in a vision, Ananias. And he said, behold, I am here, Lord. And the Lord said, arise and go into the street, which is called Straight, and inquire at the house of Judas for one called Saul of Tarsus. For behold, he prayeth, and he has seen in a vision a man named Ananias coming in and putting his hands on him that he might receive his sight. Now, Ananias at this point is thinking, this is not a good idea. This Saul guy puts people to death. You know that, don't you? It's not a good idea. Lord, do you love me, God? Do you really love me? You're sending me into battle. And goes on and says, and then Ananias answered, Lord, I have heard of many of this man and how much evil he hath done to thy saints at Jerusalem. And here hath he the authority from the chief priests to bind all them that call on his name, and you want me to go pray for him. You know what, me to go pray for him. You know how many times the Lord ever come to you with something, you're like, are you sure, Lord? Are you positive? I remember one time I was preaching a revival, and this little guy had come to church every night of the revival. God saved her, God moved on, the Spirit of God moved on, it was powerful. Well, her husband was getting very upset that she was spending all her time down at that little church. So he's going to make sure I understood that he didn't like it. So he came to my service that night. Sat right there on the front row. Here's how he sat the whole service. When everybody else was shouting, And I got to explain this to you so you get a picture of this guy. Steve, stand up back here. That guy was every bit as big as Steve, every bit as big as Steve, but he was 150% all muscle. He was a weightlifter and a bodybuilder. Yes, my God, that's what I said. And so his wife come up there because she had been seeking the requirement. And she got up there. God filled her with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. It was powerful. And then he comes walking up. And I'm like, yes, sir, can I help you? He goes, I got a word I want to speak with you. I said, stand right there. And he stood right there and I said, I'm praying, God, what am I going to do? This guy's going to punch me flat out right here. God said, here's what I want you to do. I said, yes, sir. Wrap your arms around him and hang on for the ride. And I'm like, Lord, no. I'm like, Lord, you're reminding me of Ananias now. What are you doing? He said, put your arms around me and trust me. And I said, yes, Lord. And I said, brother, God wants you to know he's real. God wants you to know he loves you today. And I reached around him, could barely lock my fingers together, you know. And I'm like, don't let me die, don't let me die, don't let me die, don't let me die. God, do not kill me, God, do not kill me. And I started praying and speaking in tongues. And all of a sudden, he went like this. He just broke. And he began to shake. And he began to cry. And the Holy Spirit moved on. When I pulled my arms around him, he fell. Poof, just like a sack. Just boom, right on the ground. To make a long story short, he was later saved and filled with the Holy Ghost. One of the great supporters of my first ministry. Amen? Praise the Lord. So I'm thankful. So God may come to you and tell you something that might be a little risky. But know if God be for you, who can be against you? Let's go on. Got lots covered. I want to get it covered. Okay, so, but the Lord said unto him, go thy way, for he is a chosen vessel unto me, to bear my name before the Gentiles and kings and children of Israel. And I will show him how great things he must suffer for my name's sake. A lot of people pass that part. He said, I want you, can you imagine, here's your Ananias, and you're going to go minister to Paul, you're going to go prophesy to him, but you're not going to go tell him, hey, the blessings will be bestowed upon you, you shall get a new Mercedes, you shall get a new house, you shall be the most popular preacher that has ever preached, you will write half of the New Testament. Oh, no, that's not what he says. Be ready, you're going to suffer.
Come on.
You got a lot of stuff to suffer. They're going to stone you, they're going to kill you, they're going to put you into jail, they're going to lock you up. That's your prophecy, bro. And that even says more about Paul's character, doesn't it? He knew what he had to face. He was willing to do it, no problem. No sweat. Let's go on, look what it says. And Ananias went his way and entered into the house. And putting his hands, oh, thank you, Jesus. Putting his hands on Brother Saul, the Lord, even Jesus, that appeared to thee in the way, has comest here to set thee free. That thou mightest receive thy sight and do what? I'm sorry, receive thy sight and do what? I can't hear you, church. Receive your sight and be what? With the Holy Ghost. Come on, man. He made a requirement. He told the same requirement that he gave the disciples, he gave to Paul. He said, you ain't going out of this house. You're not getting your sight back. It's the Holy Ghost that's going to bring that sight back. Holy Ghost is going to get it back. And see, here's the thing about it. I like to think of it this way. I know the Bible says that when Ananias laid his hands on him, it was as if there were scales fell from his eyes. And I know a lot of preachers, different people preach that as being maybe fish scales or whatever, however they want to do it. I don't really care. You know, I got to thinking of it, apostle, from a spiritual perspective. And I said, you know, Lord, for 3 days that Paul was blind, he had to think about all the things he put his confidence in, all the things he put his trust in. And it had been misplaced in all those things. And you know, I like to think this. When he received the Holy Ghost, he not only received his natural vision back, he got infused with a new Holy Ghost vision. And even though the Bible says, as it were, scales fell from his eyes, I like to think of it this way. He took the scales of judgment that Paul had used to interpret and understand the Word of God. He cast them away and gave him a new standard of judgment, a new standard of understanding, a new standard of revelation. And that was the Holy Ghost. Now I'll get back where I was going. So, Matthias was the 13th disciple. And believe it or not, Paul is the 14th disciple. So when you want to talk about disciples, Paul's the 14th. He is officially placed as the 12th in the group. But every single one of those men had a two-step process. Come on, hear me. A two-step process. First, they had to accept Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Then, they had to get the requirement. And what bothers me about this is I'm trying to figure out who has more power than God. Who has more power than Jesus Christ? I said, Brother Vanover, what are you talking about? Well, somebody canceled the requirement. And I'm trying to figure out who did it. Who changed his requirement? Who changed what he wanted? And now let me show you how strict God is on this requirement. Go with me if you would, please. Thank you, Lord. Acts chapter 6 and verse 1. And in those days, when the number of the disciples was multiplied, there arose a murmuring among the Grecians against the Hebrews because their widows were neglected in the daily menstruation. And the 12 were, and then the 12 called the multitude of the disciples unto them and said, it is not reason that we should leave the word of God and serve tables. See, the thing is, they came, there was a problem. See, they had Christians that weren't Jews. They were Greeks. And when it came time to pass out the food to the widows, the Greeks weren't getting their fair cut. They were giving more to the Jews and not enough to the Greeks. So they came and they wanted the disciples to remedy this issue. They came and wanted the disciples to take care of this. And the disciples came and said, wait a minute. We're to leave the word of God? We're to leave what God is showing us and seeking and praying and revelation that we should bring foods and take care of tables? That's what you want us to do? And I want you to look what the disciples said, what the disciples did. And they said, wherefore, my brethren, look ye out among you seven men, and look what the requirements were. Seven men of honest report, full of the Holy Ghost and wisdom, whom we may appoint over this business. But we will give ourselves continually to prayer and the ministry of the word. And the saying pleased the whole multitude. And they chose who? They chose who? Stephen, a man full of faith and what? Full of faith and what? Full of faith and what? Do you understand what this is saying? Get a hold of this. 2,000 years ago, in order to pass out a can of corn, you had to be full of the Holy Ghost. Not just baptized, full of it. Faithful, full, walking in the power, walking in the anointing. Not getting up on the pulpit preaching, not holding revivals, not holding crusades, not holding conferences, not being on the praise team, not being on the dance team, not standing at the door, not doing that, passing out corn. Are you listening to me? Passing out groceries. God required them to be filled with the Holy Ghost to pass out groceries. So my question is, if he required it just to pass out the groceries, why are we not requiring it for the men and women that stand behind this pulpit? Why are we not requiring it for the people that stand on this stage and usher people into the anointing and the power of God? Why are we not requiring it for our congregation that sits in the seat? Honey, let me tell you something. If you ain't got the Holy Ghost, you need to get it. And if you do got it, you need to get full of it. So it's coming out on every side. Amen? I didn't make this requirement. Jesus did. And I don't think he messed up on it, do you? I don't think he messed it up. So I want you to go to Acts chapter 7. Go to Acts the 7th chapter. Acts chapter 7. I want you to go there. Now, remember, I don't think people ever say it. Stephen was not doing a revival. He wasn't preaching. He wasn't ministering. He wasn't holding a revival. He wasn't doing crusades. He was passing out groceries. That's what he was doing. But he wasn't afraid, because he was full of the Holy Ghost, to speak the truth and to say the truth. So you must remember in the beginning, Stephen's original assignment was to take Groshen to the Greeks. And look what it says, verse 51. Acts chapter 7, verse 51. You stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears, you do always what? You always do what? You resist the Holy Ghost as your fathers did, so do ye. Now, I want you to look at something. Stephen looks at the scribes and Pharisees and said, you just like your fathers. He said, they resist the Holy Ghost and you resist the Holy Ghost. I got news for you. 2,000 years later in this day right here, we got more churches resisting the Holy Ghost than they are proclaiming it. We have got, why are we fighting the Holy Ghost? Why are we battling against the Holy Ghost? You afraid the Holy Ghost could embarrass you? Embarrass me all day long and five times on Sunday. I'll take it. Do you not remember David? When they brought the ark through? You don't remember David? The Bible says he stripped it down to the loincloth. And he began to dance with all his might through the town of Jerusalem. Got upstairs, and his wife, who happened to be Saul's daughter, said, you have made a fool out of yourself. You've embarrassed yourself. I like what he said. Did that offend you? Did that bother you? Did that upset you? He said, good, I'll go do it again. He said, I'll go do it again. I'll go do it again. When you get to the place where you stop worrying about people that you offend and start worrying about the God that you offend, then you will be where you need to be. If you come through that front door and you can't handle the Holy Ghost and the Word of God, and it offends you, adios. Catch you later, amigo. See you later. Yeah, see, God don't bring, oh Lord, I'm in trouble. God don't bring you to this deep well for you to tell the deep well what to do. God doesn't bring you to the deep well for you to bring it. He brought you to the deep well to receive, to take out, to change and be transformed. Don't come through the door telling. Come through the door listening, hearing what God has to say. Amen? Let's go on. So he goes on and says, which of the prophets have not your fathers persecuted? And they have slain them and showed before the coming of just one, of whom you have now been the betrayers and the murderers, who have received the law by the dispensation of angels and have not kept it. When they heard these things, they were cut to their heart. And remember, he's the grocery man. Are you getting this? He's the grocery man. And he's preaching the truth. And he goes on and says, oh God, I love this. Think of this, guys. Think of this. We come down, we get saved. We come down and get the baptism of the Holy Ghost. And that's it. We don't do anything else with it. Did you know the Bible requires you to have a daily fellowship with the Holy Ghost and the anointing of God? You're not supposed to just get the baptism and walk on. You're supposed to get baptized and then spend the rest of your life getting more in touch, getting more full, getting full, getting full, getting full, getting full till the Holy Ghost can manifest through you without hindrance. So the Holy Ghost can manifest through you without distraction. So the Holy Ghost can manifest through you and speak God's word without your changing it or justifying it. But he, being full of the Holy Ghost. Oh, I love that. Looked up steadfastly into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing on the right hand of God. And he said, behold, I see the heavens open and the Son of Man is standing on the right hand of God. And they cried out with a loud voice and stopped their ears and ran on him with one accord. They cast him out of the city and they stoned him. And the witnesses laid down their coats at a young man's feet, whose name was Saul. That's right. The 14th disciple was there. Come on, hear me. His name was Saul. After they stoned Stephen, while they were stoning Stephen, they laid their coats at his feet. They wanted his approval. They wanted to know that they had pleased someone with as much religious knowledge as he had. And I'm sorry that this is true, but it is true. Even today, there are some of you who have a calling. There are some of you who have a ministry. And the Holy Ghost really wants to move in you. All you need is to let the Holy Ghost move. But you're so interested in pleasing the religious that you have offended the righteous. Come on, hear me now. We are not here to please religion. We are not here to continue to bow to the scribes and the Pharisees. We are here to be a royal priesthood and a holy nation that God has called, that he has filled us with his word. He has filled us with the Holy Ghost. And we will carry out the mission that he has laid before us. Go on with me now. I'm going to get to it. I believe we talked about Jesus gave a requirement. Tarry in Jerusalem till you be doing on power on high. Acts 1 told us what he was talking about. That they would be filled with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. He said, John indeed baptized you with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. Okay? Now, when he said all of this, he did that, and then when Paul was called to the ministry, he made the requirement of Paul, did he not? Then he made the requirement of Saul, did he not? Yes, he did. Did you know when Barnabas was selected to go on the first missionary journey, he went and got Paul. Did you know that? He went and got him. He went to Tarsus and got him and brought him back. When they came back to Antioch, they wanted to pick 5 men that they could consider for this missionary journey. And you'll look it up in there. And they had 2 requirements for those men. What were they? They'd be full of the Word of God and they'd be full of the Holy Ghost. They had to have the Holy Ghost. The first man selected was Barnabas. The last man selected was Paul. Now, a lot of people think he changed his name. His name was changed from Saul to Paul. It was not. Saul is the Hebrew name. Paul is the Greek name. He just decided since he was ministering to the Gentiles, it would probably be more appropriate to go by the name Paul. But he had both names, but they try to tell you, well, that's a nice story, but it's not true. The true fact is the name is both Hebrew and Jewish, okay? So, but here's the thing. Every time these requirements are made, think about Paul for a minute. Do you remember the story in Paul when Paul wanted to go to Asia? Do you remember that? Do you remember Paul was set and he wanted to go to Asia and something happened? Something stopped him from going to Asia? What stopped him from going to Asia? Do you remember? The Holy Ghost compelled him not to go. Do you remember the Holy Ghost told him don't go there? When they prayed about where to go, the Holy Ghost told them where to go. When they prayed about what they need to do, the Holy Ghost told them what to do. So I got a question, church. When did we stop asking the Holy Ghost his opinion? When did we stop asking the Holy Ghost what he wants to do? When did we stop asking the Holy Ghost what needs to be done? I'm trying to figure it out. I'm trying to figure out why the church has diminished the significance, the importance, and the direction of the Holy Ghost. What is happening? What is going on? The water cleans, but the fire purifies. See, God don't just want to wash you down every week. God don't want to bring you in and wash you out every week. What God wants to do is fill you with that power and that fire of the Holy Ghost so that whenever something comes in to hinder, something comes in to distract, something comes in to tear down, that fire will consume it. That fire will burn it up. Now, I think we've presented a pretty compelling argument thus far for the significance of the importance of the Holy Spirit or the Holy Ghost. But I want to bring a little more to bear. Go with me if you would please. I want you to go with me if you would please. Go to Acts first. Go Acts chapter 10. Show me if you go to Acts chapter 10. Acts the 10th chapter. Stay with me. I got something I want to bring to you. Hang on. I'm just setting it down. Acts chapter 10. I want you to go with me to Acts chapter 10 real quick. I'm going to go to verse 44. Acts chapter 10 and verse 44. While Peter yet spake these words, the Holy Ghost fell on them that heard the word. Now, wait a minute. Peter's with the Gentiles, and Peter's preaching to the Gentiles, right? And while he is preaching, they are filled with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Now, I want to remind you, later in the scripture, it will tell you they had never been water baptized. He said, now we can go do it, but you got the Holy Ghost. You know, you're good. You're good, man.
So apparently God thought what they needed was the Holy Ghost. He said, what you need is the Holy Ghost. But how did they know they had the Holy Ghost? How did they know they had the Holy Ghost? Was there a little neon sign that said, Holy Ghost, Holy Ghost, Holy Ghost? Did they all turn polka dotted? How did they know they had the Holy Ghost? Look, this is great. And it says, and they of the circumcision. Now, those of the circumcision are the Masonic Jews, the Jews that believe in Jesus Christ. And they that are the circumcision, which believed, were astonished that as many as came with Peter, because that on the Gentiles was also poured out the gift of the Holy Ghost. How do they know? For they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God. Evidence, brother. Come on now. They had evidence. How did they know they had the Holy Ghost? They heard them speak with tongues. I'm going to tell you something. You can preach whatever you want to preach. You can say whatever you want to say. But you do not have the baptism of the Holy Ghost if you do not speak in tongues. That is the evidence. You do not have it. You cannot have it. And you know, people want to come along and say, well, you know, Brother Vanover, you get the Spirit when you get saved. And then the baptism of the Holy Ghost is an extra thing. It comes along later. I guess you haven't read your Bible very well. God does not have multiple versions of the Spirit. Do you understand that? Go read. He says, one Spirit, one Lord. Oh, somebody better hear. Only one. Now go and look what he says. We'll prove this out in Acts 19. Go with me to Acts 19. Every day I wake up, I thank God for putting Acts 19 in the Bible. Thank you, Lord. This brings it all to rest. Acts chapter 19. Now let's go. Acts 19 and verse 1. And it came to pass that while Apollos was at Corinth, Paul, having passed through the upper coast, came to Ephesus, and finding certain disciples. Now, there's something you need to hold on to here. He called them disciples. That means they knew Jesus. Come on, hear me. They knew Jesus. They weren't unsaved. They were Christians. He said they're disciples. They're Christians. They love the Lord. He found certain disciples. But he asked him a question. Now, why did he ask this question? Here's my thing. If you get the Holy Ghost when you get saved, why did Paul ask this next question? He said, have you received the Holy Ghost since ye believed? Now, folks, you can move that every way you want, but Paul is telling you right now, you do not get the Holy Ghost when you get saved. Honey, the Spirit draws you, the Spirit moves on you, but the Spirit is not a well of springing water in you till you have the baptism of the Holy Ghost. And so Paul asks them. Now, see, why is this? Because Paul knew, as he himself had experienced, it's a two-step process. And there's a reason why. Why is, and I'm going to tell you, I hope I get all this out. The reason why it's a two-step process. It's a two-step process because what is the Spirit of God? It is called the what? It's right there. What is it? What is it? What's that first word? What's that first word? What's that first word? Guess what the ghost is? Guess what the ghost is? You know what that means? It can't go into a dirty tabernacle. You know what that means? It can't, come on, it can't go in. Can't go into a sinful tabernacle. Can't go into a dirty tabernacle. Can't be, can't be, can't be, can't be. Can't happen, can't happen, can't happen. So before we could get the promise of the Father, us, who the Bible says is the temple of the living God, the temple of the Holy Ghost. Before we could become that temple, Jesus had to do what he did. He had to cover us with his blood. He had to remove, wash out all the filth, all the sin, all the disgust. He did it with his blood. His blood cleansed us. His blood washed us clean. That was step one. And now that the tabernacle, now that the tabernacle has Jesus, now the tabernacle's ready for step two, the baptism of the Holy Ghost. I
wonder how Paul knew they didn't have the Holy Ghost. Same way you know. You walk up to say, they're missing a sparkle. They're missing a light. They're missing something comes with the Holy Ghost. And probably after a conversation for a minute or two, he said, oh, you poor boys. You're still looking physical, but you got to look spiritual because God is a. To be spiritually minded is life and peace. To be carnally minded is death. All right, let's go on. So, he said, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believed? Indicating that you must get it second step. It's not, you don't get it when you get saved. And he goes on and says, and they said unto him, and this is what, unfortunately, a lot of churches are saying 2,000 years later. Well, we don't even so much as know if there whether there be any Holy Ghost. What are you talking about, Holy Ghost? What do you mean? We don't know what you're talking about. What is the Holy Ghost? We don't know what that is. And then look at the next question he asks them. It must be necessary. It must be a needed action. We think some things are needed actions that are not. This is a needed action. Paul asked it. Look what he says. And he said unto them, unto what then were you baptized? He said, if you didn't get the baptism, if you don't have the Holy Ghost, and you guys check me, a prophet check me, apostle check me if I'm wrong. I believe John said, I indeed baptize you with water. There's one coming after me who shall actually not already lose. He shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost and fire. I believe Jesus said, John baptized you with water, but I'm going to baptize you with the Holy Ghost not many days in. Isn't that right? I don't know about you, but for me, fire gets as far away from water as it possibly can be. Now you say, Brother Van, why do you keep going on it? Because the baptism he was talking about was not just modifying John's. It was about bringing a greater, better, more effective baptism that wouldn't just wash the outside, but it would wash the inside. It would burn from the inside out. It would consume everything. The Holy Ghost is that. And apparently, according to Paul, you had to have it. Because he looked at him and said, have you received it since you believe? We don't even so much as know if it be one. Then what were you baptized with? And they said, oh, well, we have the baptism of John. And I want you to look what Paul said. And then said Paul, John verily baptized with the baptism of what? What was the baptism of water? It was the baptism of what? What was the baptism of water? It was the baptism of what? That means you need to be redeemed. Is that correct? If you need repentance, you need to be redeemed, right? Then can you explain one thing for me? What did Jesus Christ do on that? What did Jesus Christ do right here? What did Jesus Christ do on this cross? Did he redeem you? Did he redeem you? Did he redeem you? Was he the answer for your repentance? Was he the answer for what you needed to repent for? Then we do not need repentance again. What we need is manifestation. What we need is revelation. What we need is to be established. That's what we need. We will run all day long to do works and ceremonies to make people think we're religious and we're holy. But my Lord, the one thing that would make you holy is the baptism of the Holy Ghost. You say, brother, how do you know the baptism of the Holy Ghost will make me holy? What's it say? What's it say? God can't make it no more simple than 2 + 2 = 4 for you. He said, be ye holy as I am. And there are only two elements that make you holy. Think about it. Only two. There are only two things that are ever called holy besides God. The Holy Bible and the Holy Ghost. You think that's a coincidence? Come on, Joseph. You think that's a coincidence? My Bible tells me there are three that bear record in heaven. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. These three bear record in heaven. Holy God, Holy Son, Holy Ghost. Y'all hear me? So guess what happens? You can take the Holy Word, but if you ain't got the Holy Ghost to release the revelation in it, if you don't got the Holy Ghost to bring the understanding, if you don't got the Holy Ghost to provide you with that interpretation, the Bible says, men of old did not speak on their own, but they spoke as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. Take the Holy Ghost, put the Holy Ghost with a holy Bible, and you will get a holy God. Come on, hear me tonight. See, God wants you to be holy as He is holy. But you ain't going to get there unless you take the Word and the Spirit. When you bring them together, they release the image and nature of Jesus Christ. Come on, I got to hurry. Hope you get something out of this. I hope I'm not just rambling on here. If you get anything out of this message, or you're blessed in any way here in the building or on the internet, then you owe me nothing. But you owe Jesus your life. Live it for Him. If you're not getting blessed at all, and you just look and say, that guy's a nut, that's fine too. Just pray for me. I use all the prayers I can get. Pray God deliver me, set me free, give me whatever it is I need. But I love the Holy Ghost, man. I love this. I know what He says. And when you heard this, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Now, folks, He didn't look for a lake. He didn't look for a pond. He didn't run out anywhere and throw them in water and try to baptize them. He did this. Come here, Mario. Stand up here, Mario. This is what He did. He said, hereby I baptize you in the name of Jesus. Fill him with the baptism of the Holy Ghost. That's what He did. And when He did that, look what happened. What did the Bible say? Bible say, and when Paul had laid his hands upon them, the Holy Ghost came upon them, and they spake in tongues and prophesied. Woo! Come on, man. Somebody love Jesus? I love Jesus. See, that's what we need, folks. We need that more than we've ever needed it in the whole world. And that is for the baptism of the Holy Ghost to begin to move forward as it's never moved forward before. And do you know why it's such an important thing? Do you know why it's so important that the Holy Ghost be a part of it? See, here's the thing. You want to minister the most precious document that was ever written, the Word of God. But you do not want to navigate it with the knowledge that wrote it. You want to add your knowledge to it, modify it, change it, and justify your own sins through it. That's not how it works. You have to humble yourself. Let the Holy Spirit bring the illumination. Let the Holy Spirit implant the knowledge and then move it forward for Jesus. Amen? Ask you a question. Go with me. I think this is what it's saying. Let me double check. Go to 1 Thessalonians. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. God's so good tonight. Love the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Okay, 1 Thessalonians. Why don't you go to the 5th chapter. 1 Thessalonians 5. Thank you, Jesus. God's so good. I want you to understand something. There are some requirements that God has. Being filled with the Holy Ghost is one of them. There's another requirement He has in Corinthians when He says something about speaking in tongues. Have you ever looked to see what He said about speaking in tongues in Corinthians? There's one requirement, one and only one. Do not forbid to speak with tongues. That's it. Nothing else you need to know. Nothing else you need to know. See, because all that stuff, Corinthians 14 is the most misquoted chapter in the entire Bible because they read it wrong. It was a letter from Paul to the church of Corinth, and he was quoting church doctrine to him all the way through it. And then he comes down at the end and says, listen, guys, you need to understand something. The things that I, Paul, have taught you and wrote to you, they are the commandments of the Lord God Almighty. He said, covenant to prophecy and forbid not to speak in tongues. Don't forbid it. What's the Bible say in 1 Thessalonians? Chapter 5. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. And I'll go to the 14th verse. Now we exhort you, brethren, warn them that are unruly, comfort the feeble-minded, support the weak, and be patient towards all men. See that none render evil for evil unto every man, but everyone follow that which is good among yourselves to all men. Rejoice evermore, pray without ceasing, in everything give thanks, for this is the will of God and Jesus Christ concerning you. 19 says what? I'm sorry, what does 19 say?
What does 19 say? So when the Holy Ghost is moving on somebody, I don't like the way it's moving, it's bothering me, I can quench it. I can shut that down. That's not what the Bible says. See, understand one thing. The Holy Ghost does not interrupt the Holy Ghost. Come on, you hear me? You understand? Holy Ghost does not interrupt the Holy Ghost. If the Holy Ghost is up here preaching, he knows that he's preaching. He knows there's a message coming forth. He knows he's feeding your spirit. He's feeding your soul. And there will become a moment when you can express that excitement. And the Holy Ghost will release it. But right now, he's showing you something. We don't require it anymore in our ministers. We don't require it anymore in our churches. We don't require it in anything. When we decide to do something for God, we get around a table, have a nice lunch, and come up with a bunch of ideas we think are good. One that we think is most popular, we'll pick it and we'll put it into operation, and we'll say that's great. What we do too often, what we do way too often, is say, God, bless what I am doing. Instead of saying, God, put me in what you're blessing. Put me in what you're blessing. And the other thing we need to say, God, you took me out of bondage. God, you took me out of sin. God, you took me out of Egypt. Now take Egypt out of me. Said, you took me out of Egypt, God. Now I want you to take Egypt out of me. Take the bondage out of me. Take the hindrance out of me. Take the distractions out of me, God. You know, the disciples came to Jesus. And they asked him. They said, we want to sit on your right side and on your left side. And these things we want to do. And he said, you know that. I'm paraphrasing now. He kind of said, that's really kind of irrelevant. It doesn't make any difference. I don't have the power over that. It's God's decision. He says, but what you need to know, can you drink? Can you drink from the cup that I drink from? He said, can you handle the baptism that I'm about to bring? He said, can you handle this baptism I'm bringing? Can you do it? And he said, yay, you can. You can drink from the cup. You can handle it. It's coming for you. Amen. Now, there's an interesting thing in Matthew 12. I'm sorry. Go to Matthew 12. I want to read something to you. And I think this is quite interesting. Matthew 12. You know, churches are very popular and very well known for discussing all kinds of sin and telling you what a big bad sinner you are and how that you're going to go to hell for this and that and everything else. But isn't it amazing? There is one particular thing that you really can go to hell for. Express ticket straight to hell. And it's found in Matthew 12. Matthew 12 and verse 31. Matthew 12. Would you go over Matthew 12? And this is verse 31. And this is red letter edition. Jesus, you can't argue. Okay, go with me. 12 and 31. Wherefore I say unto you, who's saying it? Jesus. Who's saying it? Jesus. Is it debatable? No. Is it disputable? No. Can you change it? No. All manner of sin and blasphemy shall be forgiven unto men. But the blasphemy against the Holy Ghost shall not be forgiven unto men. Woo! There's one unforgivable sin. Suicide might fall in that category too, but this one's for sure. If you blaspheme the Holy Ghost, you will not receive forgiveness, period. Do you get that? Now stay with me. I'm going to show you why. Hang on with me. He goes on and says, and whosoever speaketh the word. Now listen, man. He says, you can speak against Jesus, and you shall be forgiven. He said, whoever speaketh the word against the Son of Man, it shall be forgiven him. But whosoever speaketh the Holy Ghost, it shall not be forgiven him, neither in this world, nor in the world to come. Do you understand how powerful that singular statement is? If you blaspheme or speak against the Holy Ghost, you will not receive forgiveness in this life nor the one to come. And then this brings a question to Timothy. Why? Why? Why is that such a heavy penalty? There has to be a reason why that's such a heavy penalty. Now, don't get me wrong. I got the baptism of the Holy Ghost. I know the Holy Ghost is great. But there's a reasoning there. There are three that bear record in heaven. Father, Son, Holy Ghost. You can blaspheme God, be forgiven. Blaspheme Jesus, be forgiven. You blaspheme the Holy Ghost, it's over. There's no forgiveness. Now, for me, I don't know about you guys, but if people told me if you ate a carrot, it would kill you, I would never eat no more carrots. I'd be done. I'm not going to ever eat another carrot again. I don't need them anyway, but I wouldn't eat them then. if they told me if you eat it, it's going to kill you, I'd say, nah, that's okay. I don't need it. Why is it when we hear this is unforgivable, it doesn't send off one single alarm to us? Doesn't make one single church stop and think, wait a minute, are we paying enough attention to the Holy Ghost? Are we getting out of the way and letting the Holy Ghost call some shots around here? Are we making sure that everybody on that praise team speaks in tongues? Are we making sure that everybody behind that pulpit speaks in tongues? And if we're not, we will be accountable to God for filling our pulpit. Oh, Lord, help me, Jesus. He said, for filling our pulpit with corrupted tabernacles. Come on, baby. I don't want to fill it with a corrupted tabernacle. Can I tell you why? Will you stick with me? Can you give me 10? Give me just a few more minutes, and I can show you why baptism of the Holy Ghost is unforgivable. Go with me, Matthew 1. Go with me, Matthew 1, the first chapter of Matthew. You guys all know the story of Jesus. You know how Mary, the virgin, became impregnated with Jesus. Well, Mary was espoused to a man. And back then, for a woman to be pregnant out of wedlock was a disgrace. It would have disgraced his family, her family, everybody's family. So this happened. Go with me to Matthew chapter 1. And let's see here. Okay, let's go on. Go Matthew 1, and I want to go start in 10. Now, the birth of Jesus Christ on this wise, when his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of what? Who was she found child of? Found of the child of the what? Stick with me, I'm going. Hang on. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man and not willing to make her a public example, was minded to put her away privately. But when he thought on these things, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a dream, saying, Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary thy wife, for that which she has conceived is of the what? I'm sorry, I can't hear you. It's of the what? It's of the what? Now I want you to wait a minute. If I'm an angel going to tell you your wife that you're getting ready to marry was impregnated, I'm using the biggest name I can come up with. I'm going to say, God did it, deal with it. You know, God made it happen, deal with it. You got to do that. But isn't it funny? The angel didn't say that. Two times in that chapter, he said she was impregnated by the Holy Ghost. And you say, well, I thought he was God's son. He is God's son. But God used the Holy Ghost as a spiritual agency to deliver that promise and that gift unto us. Now, something you need to understand, here's the power of it. Oh, God, this is power. The Holy Ghost impregnated Mary with Jesus Christ. What do you think he's doing to you? What do you think he wants to do to you? He wants to impregnate you with the image and the nature of Jesus Christ. You say, Brother Vanover, what are you talking about? Don't you understand? The Holy Ghost has got Jesus Christ's DNA. Oh, you ain't listening. The Holy Ghost has got his DNA. He wants to impregnate you with that image. God used the Holy Ghost. The Bible says God overshadowed her, and the Holy Ghost conceived the child. Isn't that what it says? What's it? See, God is holy. He cannot be corrupted. He can't be around corruption. He can't be corrupted. So he used the Holy Ghost as an agency to transfer the DNA of Jesus Christ into Mary so that his son would be born. But it would also provide a spiritual highway, a spiritual principle that when you become the temple of the living God, when you become the temple of the Holy Ghost, when you are saved and filled with the baptism of the Holy Ghost, his DNA resonates in your spirit. His DNA is in you. And as you begin to get away, as you begin to bring that flesh under subjection, as you begin to get under it, guess what happens? His image and nature begins to come. His image and nature begins to birth and come alive in you. Amen?
Yes.
Now say it with me. Stay with me now. That is why when you blaspheme the Holy Ghost, oh gosh, when you blaspheme the Holy Ghost, you have aborted any chance for Christ to be birthed in you. Oh, y'all ain't listening to me. Think about this for a minute. Why does he not forgive you in this life and the life to come? Because you have aborted any chance for life. You have aborted any chance. The devil loves abortion because it is not life. He loves death. We do not serve a God of the dead. We serve a God of the living. The Lord told me one time, he said, Timothy, I hate abortion and I hate homosexuality for the exact same thing. And I said, what's that, Lord? He said, neither one produces life. Neither one has the power or the capability to produce life. They are elements of death. They are elements of destruction. They are the elements that no longer produce life. Honey, as the Bob Church, the Church of the Redeemed, it is time that we begin to stand up. Time to begin to defend the Holy Ghost. Time to begin to say, bring the Holy Ghost back into our churches. Stronger and greater than ever before. And now I got to close, so stay with me. Okay, here's the thing. Here's the thing. Jesus, he was the divine Son of God. He had a deity. Jesus never used his divine nature when he was on the earth. Had he used it when he was on the earth, you and I would be in trouble because we don't have that nature and we can't lock into that deity. But read your Bible. Everything Jesus did while he was on this earth, he did it through the Holy Ghost. Read it, through the Holy Ghost. Through the Holy Ghost. Over and over you heard him say, I am the Son of Man. I'm 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 the Son of Man. Why? Jesus had come to be a substitutionary sacrifice for you. To be your substitute on that cross. Amen? If he had have used his deity and his divine nature, you would not be able to bring that complete image to life. But because he didn't, because he did it with the Holy Ghost, he did it with the Word of God, the two elements that are holy, Holy Ghost and the Holy Word, he used them together to establish the holiness of God in the hearts of men. And see, that's why you need those two elements, because it's those two elements, the Word and the proper spiritual interpretation and understanding, to release the revelation that will change you and will present to you the DNA of Jesus Christ. That dynamic new anointing that you need in you. Amen. Praise God. Now I'll tell you one more thing. I'm going to let go. The reason Jesus did not use his deity up until this point is he was saving it for something. You see, when Jesus was on the cross, he was on there as the Son of Man. And the devil went nuts when he saw Jesus on there. And he threw everything there was at him. He threw everything he could at him. And that's why Jesus on that cross, I still love that story. If you go read Isaiah, read all the Isaiah 50s, they talk about this experience. And this is why the centurion, Apostle Fisher, when he was standing on the cross, said what he said. There was a centurion assigned to the cross of Jesus Christ. You understand, centurion means this is a war-battled veteran. This is a guy that commands men. He's a war, seen everything in war and combat. And he looks up at Jesus. And the Bible tells us that his vision was so marred, it didn't even resemble a man anymore. And can you imagine 30 years, a lifetime of alcoholism, a lifetime of drug abuse, cancer, this disease, that disease, every disease coming on Jesus, everything coming on him, he transfigured before them. Alcoholic, gone. Drug addiction, gone. Sin, gone. Death, gone. Cancer, gone. Sickness, gone. He went through it all. And then when he came to the very last thing, he said, God, it is finished. And he died. And when he did, that centurion said, for truly. And it wasn't because the ground quaked. It wasn't because the clouds turned gray. He looked at him and said, truly, this man was the Son of God. I watched him transform through everything man will face and go back to that beaten flesh we stuck up there. He said, we killed the Son of God. We killed the Son of the living God. But here's what happened. The devil was a shouting. He was happy he killed the Son of God. Mm-mm. I killed the Son of God. Mm-mm. And in hell, the party was on, baby. The lava mountains were flowing and heaven, I mean, they were having a party. They said, we've defeated God. We've defeated Jesus. We've killed him. And then all of a sudden, in the middle of their party, they hear, man, we're having a party. Who's knocking on the gate this time of night? Lion devil, go see who that is. So the lion devil runs to the gate and he looks and he sees Jesus standing on the other side of the gate. And he goes, oh, and he comes back. He comes back over to Satan and says, Satan, you got to take this one yourself. This ain't mine. You got to take this one yourself. He goes, what do you mean? He goes, I ain't lying this time. It's Jesus. It can't be Jesus. I killed Jesus. Nope, you better go see. So when the devil went to the gate, there was Jesus. He said, wait a minute. I put you on the cross. I put every sin, every disease known to anybody on you. He said, yeah, but you forgot one thing. What's that? I'm not the Son of Man. I am the Son of the Living God. And when he said that, those gates swung open. Jesus walked right into hell. And he said, I'll take it right now. I'll take it right now. Satan, give me the keys of death in the grave. Give it to me now. It's mine. And then Jesus proceeded to have a little revival in hell. Because what did he need? See, he was so awesome. That's what he needed the deity for, was to take back what the devil had stole from us. He paid for the wages of sin with his life. He filled us with the ability to produce his image in nature. And he returned to us the power of victory and of life. Praise God. Amen. So, we have to ask the question, where's the requirement? Can we truly ignore the requirement when Jesus made it and commanded it from every single person that ever followed him, from passing out corn to writing 70% of the New Testament to going on a missionary journey? I don't know, man. I think we as ministers need to purify our churches. The people on your stage need to be filled with the Holy Ghost and speaking in tongues. Don't just put them on there because they're the best singer. Don't put them on there because they're the best musician. I don't care how good a musician you are. I don't care how good a singer you are. If you're not anointed, you're worthless on that stage. Do you understand me? I said you're worthless on that stage. I'd rather have somebody out there who couldn't carry a tune in a bucket full of the anointing and the Holy Ghost of God, people getting blessed, people getting touched, than the greatest singer you ever saw. I'm going to say something make a lot of people mad, but you'll get over it. Honey, you need to understand something. God's not interested in your pride. God's not interested in who you are. God's not interested in how great you think you are. God's not interested if you're going to be the next Christian superstar. God don't need no superstars. We got the bride and the morning star. We don't need no more Christian superstars. It wasn't a Christian superstar that saved my soul. Purify your churches. Pastors, purify them. You want the power of God to move in your church? Make some requirements. Let's begin to worship. Let's begin to praise the Lord. Today when I was seeking God and I was praying, God spoke to me about you, my brother. God spoke to me about you. And I don't understand everything this means. You may understand it better than me. But God said, there's a new step. And I don't know what this means, but I'm seeing armor being put on you. I'm seeing shiny armor being put on you. And God said, son, get ready.
It's a new step. It's a new day. You're about to walk. You're about to walk into the greatest day of your life. Praise God. Love that, brother. Sister Deidre, come here, babe. Come here, honey. God spoke to me about you all night last night and all day today. Come over here. I love this girl. This girl loves Jesus. This girl loves Jesus. Girl loves this church. Girl loves the apostle. Loves this place. Once you lift up your hands, just begin to seek the Lord. God told me something about you. He said, daughter, get ready. He said, it's shift time. It's level increase time. God wants you to move up to higher levels. He's going to bring you up to higher level. He said, get ready. Greater commitment. Greater depth. Oh, rabababakos. See? Yeah. That new level. New level. New level. New level. Praise the Lord. It's a new level. Touch her, Jesus. There it is. There it is. There it is. Thank you, Jesus. A new level. A new level. A new level. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. But I saw you sitting at a table. And there was this box before you. And it was the most beautiful box I have ever seen. With colors I've never seen. And I saw you opening the box. But you opened it so respectfully. So gently. And I saw the anointing of the Lord begin to rise out of the box. And I saw him say, daughter, I love you. I love your heart. And he says, when you pray, I set to hear your voice. For I love your prayers. And he says, because you pray to me with purity and honesty, I'm giving you a new box. With even, oh, a new box. He said, the next time you write, it will blow you away. You will say, my Lord, where did that come from? And he said, this is your new box because I love your mouth of prayer. I love your mouth of prayer. Praise
Apostle Fisher, the wonderful Pastor Patricia Fisher. Thank you for letting us come. Thank you for letting us share Jesus. I pray that we bring honor to your house. I pray that we bring nothing to your house but honor. And I pray if you're watching tonight, if I have done or said anything that offended you in any way, I'm sorry, I cannot apologize. Tonight was the Holy Ghost. And I will not speak against him. And I will not speak against what he said tonight. Jesus had a requirement. And my question is, why would you fight against the requirement? It's time. It's time for the church to yield to the Holy Ghost. And I'm not talking about just mentioning his name. I'm not talking about just talking to about him when you come to church. I'm talking about yielding to his voice, yielding to his direction, yielding to his guidance. We all must obey that. Thank you so much. I love each and every one of you. I love this Chicago tribe.
Hello, my name is Ryan Colley. I'm International Evangelist and Administrative Vice President of Revival for Christ Club International Ministries. We'd like to thank you so much for tuning into our program today. And if you would like to help us take revival around the world to our over 17 churches in the Philippines, to our friends in Honduras, Mexico, Singapore, and Malaysia, this is how you can do it. First off, you can send in your checks or money orders to 1005 Southwest 4th Street in Moore, Oklahoma, 73160. You can also call in with credit card at 405-793-1777. That's 405-793-1777. And finally, you can do it through the Cash App. That's money sign RFC ROAR. That's money sign RFC ROAR. Thanks in advance for helping us take the flame around the world. Remember, we are a ministry with a vision built on a plan, the Word of God.